Hello, I'm Dr. Bridget Nash, and I'd like to welcome you to The Therapy Show, a podcast series that seeks to explain the leading forms of psychological therapy in a way that is understandable to everyone. Today, I'm honored to welcome Dr. Peta Stapleton, who has over 25 years of experience as a clinical and health psychologist. Dr. Stapleton is currently an associate professor in psychology at Bond University in Australia, and in 2019, she was named Psychologist of the Year by the Australian Allied Health Awards. Dr. Stapleton is the world's leading researcher in emotional freedom techniques, which is commonly called EFT or tapping, and has established herself as one of Australia's leading online health professionals. One of Dr. Stapleton's most significant contributions to the field of mental health was to lead the world's first randomized clinical trials investigating the effectiveness of EFT. I encourage you to read Dr. Stapleton's new book, The Science Behind EFT Tapping, which was published in 2019. Dr. Stapleton, welcome to The Therapy Show.
Oh, Bridget, it's an absolute pleasure to join you today.
Can you start by telling us a little bit about your personal background and professional development that led you to the field of EFT?
Absolutely. So I've been a clinical and health psychologist now for about 25, maybe a little bit longer years, and traditionally trained in all of the mainstream therapies. But it was probably about 18 years ago, I was working in the field of eating disorders. That is my clinical background. And probably out of sheer impatience or desperation, I found that the traditional techniques weren't necessarily helping my clients, particularly those with anorexia nervosa, recover. So I started to, I guess, take that quite personally and started to look for other things out there. And it just so happened that I had a colleague who said to me one day, look, I've come across a really unusual technique. He actually called it strange. And he said, but I think it works. Now, I promptly dismissed him because I didn't even know what he was talking about at this point. And it was back in the day of dial-up internet. So you might remember how slow that was. He was such a patient man and I wasn't. Anyway, he ended up coming along to one of my support groups to help me because the groups were getting larger in number locally and we were running this weekly free support group for eating disorder sufferers. And in the middle of one of these groups, we had a young girl who started to have a panic attack. Now, he gestured he would take her off to a room just to help calm her down and I was teaching whatever the lesson was. And they were back in about 5 to 10 minutes time. And she was calm and composed. And I felt convinced, I wrote about this in the book, I felt convinced he might have popped her a Valium or something, which would have been highly unethical. But she was so calm, I didn't know what had happened. So everyone went home and I said to him, what happened with this young girl? I could clearly see she was having a panic attack. And he said to me, I did that tapping thing I've been trying to tell you about. So he'd tried 2 months earlier, introduced me to this idea of tapping. And of course, then I saw the outcome in this therapy support group. So of course, then I was very intrigued and he passed a baton, if you like. We learned what tapping was. We started to apply it in our clinical work. And then that led ultimately into the research because I was always in academia. So it was sort of an unusual introduction and I did dismiss him. I didn't understand anything that he was talking about. But then when I saw the outcome in that support group, it really did change what I started to be open to, I guess. And the rest is history, really, with where we've come with all the research.
How would you briefly explain EFT to a non-professional?
Yeah, so EFT stands for Emotional Freedom Techniques. That's just the term that sort of was around way back in the beginning. It has become known as tapping, like you mentioned, Bridget, because what it is we tap on pressure points that are on the face and the body, like what are used in acupuncture, but we use the tapping technique with two fingers rather than acupuncture needles. So it's almost like a psychological version of acupuncture. What we know through the research is that stimulating those pressure points sends a signal back to some of the stress centers in the brain, the amygdala and the hippocampus, and calm that part of the brain down. What people then report is obviously a much calmer physical feeling or emotional sensation, but also the ability to think more clearly about whatever it was that they were tapping on. So ultimately, when you think about it, it's a stress reduction tool. And what we're doing is tapping with two fingers on acupressure points on the body.
So when and how did you realize that EFT would be an effective form of therapeutic intervention?
I guess after that support group night where I saw in action the outcome of just a couple of minutes of tapping on this young girl, and then we went off and trained, we noticed quite quickly, colleagues and I, that people were getting really fast outcomes. I was applying it in the area of eating disorders. So stress around binge eating episodes for someone with bulimia nervosa, or the anxiety of returning to eating for someone with anorexia, that they were really calming down quite fast and able to then take the next steps in their therapy journey to recover. So we started to notice it really fast. It was then that we started to investigate it at a research level and more at those big clinical trial levels where hundreds of people were going through them, that we noticed everybody got these kind of outcomes, that it wasn't this one-off individual sort of outcome that people were getting, but whole groups were getting the same outcomes. So that really cemented the idea for us that this was a genuine therapeutic intervention that a lot of people could benefit from.
You mentioned eating disorders. Who is EFT most effective for, and why should people choose an EFT intervention?
For us, most of our research here in Australia has been in that food space. So we have done a lot of research now over a dozen years in the area of food cravings, weight loss, and obesity, mainly because that's a crisis that is happening here locally for us in our country. So in Australia, the research is very solid for anything to do with weight loss and food cravings, that type of thing. In the US, we have a really robust database of research now that shows EFT is highly effective for post-traumatic stress disorder. So any of those symptoms related to PTSD or distress, that type of thing, the research is really robust in that area too. So we have lots of research in lots of other pockets. And ultimately, sometimes people might ask, why does it work for so many different things? And the common denominator across most conditions is stress. So if we are applying tapping to some sort of stress in a problem, then that's why we see an outcome. So of course, we have research for things like phobias, as well as chronic pain and depression and things like that. But what we're applying it to all the time is different levels of stress.
And what about OCD?
Yes. So I'm not aware, and I'm across most research worldwide, we haven't had a clinical trial in OCD be run and published at that level, but we certainly have a lot of individual case studies. I have applied it. So OCD is a bit of a parallel area in eating disorders for myself clinically. So we have done a lot in the area at a case study level of applying it to OCD, and it works as effectively as some of the other gold standard therapies that exist.
What's the average length of treatment for somebody working with EFT?
We did look at this just to boil it down, and mostly for most conditions that probably are diagnostic, somewhere between 6 and 10 sessions. So certainly we know for post-traumatic stress disorder, 6 to 10 sessions is enough for most people to actually recover and no longer meet diagnostic criteria. Most of the treatment trials we run are about 8 weeks, so they get 2 hours tapping a week. So that's about equivalent of 16 hours. And most of the time, we've just done 2-year follow-up on some of our weight trials. And 2 years later, people have continued to have maintained the weight loss, the food cravings haven't come back, that type of thing. So we know those lengths of treatments, when you think about it, it's not very long, 8 sessions, 10 sessions, that type of thing. It maintains over time. So that's quite encouraging.
So what skills, habits, or tactics can patients and therapists adopt either during their sessions or in between sessions to improve the effectiveness of EFT?
So we definitely encourage, once a health professional is trained to use it, that they use that hour that they have, that session with a client, to actively do tapping. When you think about it, the therapist gets as much of a benefit. So I could do sort of 5 clients in a row and feel fantastic, which is not usual when you're doing talk therapies. Because if you're tapping every single session with the client in that hour, they're getting that benefit. We do teach clients outside of session, if they feel okay, that they can continue their tapping. So they could use it just for self-regulation. They don't necessarily have to do anything therapeutic or be working through a past memory. They can save that for the time with the therapist. But we do encourage them, and we teach them how to use it as a self-regulation, just a stress management tool every day in between.
What are the most common obstacles that prevent therapists and patients alike from seeing the full benefit of EFT?
I think the most common thing I've heard over the last 20 years is almost a disbelief that how can something that appears so easy and simple work? So I think at some level we're programmed in the therapy space to expect things to be lengthy and complex. And if you've had a problem you've had for a long time, you expect therapy is going to take a long time to overcome that. And I think when people first come into tapping, they realize it not only works quickly, so you could do a couple of rounds of tapping and all of a sudden become aware of something that you'd kept buried for years. So they realize it works quite fast. It almost takes their breath away. But it's almost then a disbelief that they feel calm after their tapping session, and then they wonder, is my problem going to come back? We know our long-term follow-up trials show that it doesn't. It actually has the ability to rewire brain pathways. So I think people have this disbelief that it's almost staying open to the possibility that therapy and overcoming problems does not have to take a very long time, and it doesn't have to be painful, difficult, and complex. It actually can be much more easy, but also briefer than what we've expected in the past.
Can you share any poignant examples of where EFT had a major impact in someone's life?
Oh, I have years of examples. Let me think of a couple. We've certainly in that food weight space had people who have done tapping, not knowing. So they come into our food craving trials and we do exposure therapy. So they do bring in their food and we tap on the food. So whatever it is that's appealing about that food, because we're trying to decrease the intensity of it. We had one gentleman who was in his 70s, so he was up that end in age, had this food craving for roast chickens for most of his life. He ate one every day, like a whole roast chicken, so you can appreciate it was impacting his weight. But he didn't know where it came from. He volunteered to work with the therapist in the group setting. It only took about 15 minutes of tapping for him to have the memory come up of where that had come from. And it was quite a young childhood memory. He was about 8 or 9 and it was a birthday celebration. So he didn't remember, although it was there. And it was tapping that helped uncover that. So he was just tapping on the aspects of the roast chicken that he loved. And what had happened when he was 8 was it was his birthday and his mother had said, what would you like for your birthday dinner? And he said, can I have a roast chicken dinner? And she's like, oh, would you like something more special than that? That's quite a common weekly thing. And he said, they had a lot of brothers and sisters in the family. And he said, no, that's my favorite dinner, but I want to eat the whole thing and not share it with any of my brothers and sisters. So she allowed him to. And we worked through that with tapping. But what had happened was a very positive association had been attached to the chicken. And he was still trying to find that, obviously 60 years later. We've had chronic pain cases where we had a gentleman that came up to us and they'd only done a 4-hour intensive tapping session in a health program on chronic pain. And he'd had a workplace accident 20 years earlier and was on an insurance payout disability pension that was coming to an end. And he realized just in that 4 hours of tapping that the pain at that point was quite psychological for him, not physical. And he realized he'd been hanging on to it because he didn't want to return to work. And if the pain went away, of course, he would have had to have returned to work, but he was right near transitioning into retirement at that point. So he wasn't going to have to go back to work. And funnily enough, in the next month or two, the chronic pain that he'd been carrying for 20 months completely disappeared when he transitioned into retirement and never returned. So things like that that come up and the root cause that we look for as therapists can come up quite fast in therapy. So I have dozens and dozens and dozens of cases, but they're just a couple to let our listeners know.
So who is EFT not appropriate for?
Look, what we would say at, I guess, a duty of care level, and lay people can go out and train in EFT and go through certification processes and mentoring in order to be able to become a practitioner. What we do say, even if that's the case, is don't go where you don't belong. So if somebody has diagnostic issues, like they have been diagnosed with things and you're not a licensed mental health care professional, even though you may be an EFT practitioner, we would highly recommend that clients like that still get looked after and are under the care of someone that does tapping but that is a licensed healthcare professional. So for myself, for example, we have lots of, again, case studies in the autism area where EFT tapping is highly effective for clients with autism for a range of different aspects to do with that condition. But myself, even though I'm a registered psychologist and an EFT trainer and researcher. That's not my specialty area. So I would not just willingly offer to do tapping for someone's child with autism because it's not my area. So we just sort of suggest to people to be aware and duty of care that even though you may know a little bit of tapping, you've had great success yourself, doesn't necessarily mean to go out there and start to offer it to everybody. And the caveat on that is it works really incredibly fast sometimes. It takes people's breath away, like we said. It's quite remarkable. And sometimes that can leave the practitioner speechless as well and wonder where to go. So we do recommend, if you are interested in helping others, to absolutely get supervision and mentoring and make sure that you're not going where you don't belong.
What are you most excited about in mental health treatment today?
I guess I am excited that we're calling the body-based therapies and including EFT, we would extend that to things like EMDR and some of the somatic processing therapies. We're calling that the fourth wave that we think is coming through the therapy space. So obviously we came from the first wave, psychodynamics, second wave, the behavioralists, third wave, the CBT and hybrids, mindfulness, things like that coming out of the third wave, which we've really had. But I think the fourth wave is coming into the therapy space, which is almost a bit of a return to some of the body-based approaches, but at a therapeutic level. So the talk therapy is going alongside with that. And I'm really excited to see that because I think we are seeing more trauma-informed therapists adding that to their modalities. And I think clients are benefiting from that, that the traditional talk therapies and cognitive restructuring hasn't helped a lot of people with a lot of different conditions, but some of the body-based things are fulfilling that gap. So that makes me really excited. I wrote a lot about the fourth wave in The Science Behind Tapping if people want to read a little bit more, but I'd say watch this space. I think we're going to see a shift and I think it's going to be huge.
If you had a magic wand and could improve one thing about mental health treatment today, what would it be?
I'd probably go back 20 years ago and have it start to be taught trauma-based and certainly body-based therapies at the academic level because they're our students that are coming out, becoming graduates, going out into the therapy world. Would have loved to have seen this 20 years ago. I don't think we were quite ready then. If anything, my hope is that we do see it start to be taught at this level in academia so that our new graduates who are out there in the next couple of decades assisting clients have these skills. We have just heard that there is a university in Paris, France, that for the first time, and we believe the first in the world, now teaches EFT in their Masters of Psychology program, which is, I'm just like, you could have heard me shouting from Australia when I heard that about 3 weeks ago, that that's a sign that it's now actually being taught at this level, which I think is fantastic.
How can my audience learn more about your work, either online or in print?
So my main website, which is just peterstapleton.com, just has all the information about EFT, links to our research, that type of thing. We do run trainings here in Australia, but we have trainers around the world, and that website is evidencebasedeft.com. And again, lots of free things that are available on there, as well as links to videos to have a watch and start to get started if people wanted to. And there's also practitioners trained around the world if someone wanted to actually access someone to go and see.
So Dr. Stapleton, on behalf of myself, my listeners, and all of the people that you have helped through your work, I want to thank you for your contributions to mental health treatment and for taking the time out of your busy schedule to help me and my audience better understand the field of EFT.
It's my absolute pleasure, Bridget. Thank you so much for the opportunity today.
Be sure to check out my website, www.therapyshow.com. which has many resources about mental health, and there will be a page dedicated to Dr. Stapleton's work. There you will also find how to submit questions, stories, or insights that you have about the mental health system, or suggestions about who else I can interview and how I can improve the show. I'd like to close by reminding our listeners to please subscribe, share, and review this podcast so you, someone you love, and people around the world can gain more benefit from therapy. There is no need to suffer in silence. Get the help that you need to create the life that you want.